By the time he was crucified, Jesus had been up about 36 hours without any sleep. We know from biblical accounts that Jesus was an early riser. There are several places in the gospel where he arose early and went and prayed. We have no reason to believe that he did anything other than that the day he had his last meal with his disciples. He likely arose early that morning and spent his day and subsequently had dinner with his disciples that night, the Last Supper in the upper room. He was then taken prisoner in the Garden of Gethsemane and was led about the old city of Jerusalem and was tried at least twice. The next day, about daybreak, he was actually hung on the cross and hung there throughout the day. Between the time he arose and the time he actually died on the cross, a period of about 36 hours had passed, with no sleep and no rest. Something else you may not have thought of was how far Jesus actually walked about the old city of Jerusalem. We know he was led about from the chief priest's house to Herod's to Pilate's during the time he was being tried. And we know he was led about the old city of Jerusalem. If you add it up, he walked about 2.5 miles that last night. Also, as best we can ascertain from historical accounts, Jesus carried his cross about 1/3 of a mile before he collapsed and wasn't able to carry it anymore. These are some physical exertions that added up and placed stress on a person. The next thing I want to talk about is a phenomenon called hemophidrosis. Hemophidrosis is a very rare medical phenomenon that has been reported about 12 to 14 times in world medical literature and is only seen in people who are under tremendous stress and agony. In hemophidrosis, a person actually exudes blood from every sweat gland in their body. Each sweat gland, it has a small capillary that surrounds it, and in hemophidrosis, that small capillary ruptures. As it bursts, the person actually bleeds into their sweat glands. Instead of perspiring sweat, if you will, they actually perspire blood. The Bible gives us an excellent description of this phenomenon, saying that the Lord's sweat became as drops of blood. Indeed, every pore of Jesus' body oozed and drained blood. Now, I believe that Christ was a man, just as any one of us. But at the same time, I believe that Christ was God and knew the terrible fate that lay ahead of him. He knew the job he had come to do on this earth, the mission he had to fulfill. And I believe the man part of Christ dreaded this agonizing death and torture that lay a few hours ahead of him, just as much as any of us would. We know he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, saying, "Father, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me." But he submitted his will to his Father's. There in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus was under as much anxiety and physical stress from an emotional standpoint that a human could experience, knowing that in a few hours he would be delivered into one of the most agonizing and brutal deaths ever recorded in history. Why didn't the Lord bleed to death if he bled out of every sweat gland of his body? If you've been to Israel, you know that this time of year you have warm days and cool nights. It was this cool night air that probably caused the Lord's damp skin covered with sweat and blood to chill, causing the capillaries to constrict and stop bleeding. The cold air causes the blood vessels to constrict and causes the blood loss to be minimal. But by the time Jesus was taken by the soldiers from the Garden of Gethsemane, he probably had a mixture of sweat and blood all over his entire body surface. I can imagine this was some sight to behold. Let's talk about the scourging. A scourging was a horrible torture that Roman citizens were forbade to be scourged. Only slaves and traitors could be scourged. It was one of the worst punishments the Romans had to inflict on a human body. Typically, the victim was stripped completely naked and tied by his wrist to a post or a wall with his back exposed. He was then whipped from the back of his arms, down to his shoulders and back, across his bare buttocks, down the back of his legs and calves, all the way down to his heels by two Roman legionnaires, one on either side, alternating blows. The historical accounts tell us that the traditional scourging consisted of 39 lashes. If you can, imagine two large, strong, burly Roman legionnaires, someone that we would equate to, say, a pro football player today, with a wooden-handled whip about 18 inches long that had 9 leather thongs, something akin to what we would call a cat-o'-nine-tails. The 9 leather thongs were about 6 to 7 feet long, and at the end of each thong was some lead shot, like a sinker you'd use to go fishing. Attached to the lead shot were pieces of sheep and cattle bone. And the idea of those small pieces of bone was that as the Roman legionnaire would beat his victim, snapping his wrist would cause the weight of the metal shod to dig into the back, while the sheep cattle bone cut the skin. As the sheep cattle bone lacerated the skin and actually dug in under the surface of the skin, the skilled and trained legionnaire could whip his wrist and literally lift small shards of skeletal muscle out through the skin, leaving small ribbons of muscle about 2 inches long hanging through the skin. One lash with this whip, one thong, would make a cut about 2 inches long and about 3/4 of an inch deep. To put that into medical terms, that's a cut that would take about 20 stitches to close. So with one lash, one swing of the whip, a total of 9 lacerations could be inflicted on the victim, each laceration 2 inches long and 3/4 to 1 inch deep. With one blow, the Roman legionnaire could inflict enough wounds to take 180 stitches to close. If you multiply that times 39, those two Roman legionnaires inflicted enough lacerations to take about 2,000 stitches to close. This gives you an idea of the amount of physical trauma that was inflicted upon Jesus just from the scourging. Again, you'd ask why Jesus didn't bleed to death. And again, you have to remember that this was done in the cold of night air, the very thing that causes blood vessels and capillaries to constrict and actually cause the blood loss from this beating to be minimal. As I mentioned, the idea of the lead weight was to lift the skeletal muscle out. I want you to imagine having a cut on your skin with an inch of muscle pulled out through the cut, exposed to the night air. This would be similar to a stab wound, or when people are stabbed with a sharp object like sticks, and the muscles are pulled back through the skin. The purpose this served in the scourging was that the victim hung on the cross in the heat of the day, and birds could land on him and actually peck and pull at these pieces of muscle, just like a robin trying to pull a worm out of the ground. And frequently, how long a person actually survived on the cross during a crucifixion was determined by how severely he was scourged. Sometimes they would beat a man nearly to death before they put him on the cross, and he would only live a few hours. Most of the time, though, the scourging was intended for public humiliation and embarrassment, because it was such an inhumane method of torture. We know that Jesus was beaten in the face and head as he was mocked. I can assure you with all confidence that by the time the Lord was crucified after his beatings, it's almost certain that both of his eyes were swollen shut, and no doubt his nose was pouring blood. If Jesus was tied and held and beaten in the face by these strong legionnaires, I don't think there's any doubt that his lips were tattered like paper, and some of his teeth were knocked loose or maybe even knocked out. You might ask if his jaw bones were broken. Normally they would be, but not in Jesus' case. And I'll tell you why in a few minutes. During Jesus' trials and humiliation, we also know that a crown of thorns was plaited and placed on his head. I'm sure some of you have been to Israel and have seen these thorns. I have not. They're about 1.5 to 2 inches long, and they're as sharp as an ice pick. The custom was to take a small 3 or 4 foot long reed and slap the thorns on top of the head of the victim in order to drive the thorns into the skull. Those thorns laid upon someone's head and then tapped down with a reed were hard enough to penetrate the outer table or the outer bone of the skull. Imagine the bleeding from 300 or 400 puncture wounds in the scalp and around the forehead from these thorns. Imagine the pain. So before Jesus' crucifixion even begins, his face had been beaten to a pulp. No doubt his eyes were swollen shut, his nose is bloodied, and I remind you that every pore in his skin is wept and oozed blood. Every visible surface on the good Lord Jesus, I am confident, was covered in cake with dry blood. And his back and his arms and his buttocks and the back of his legs were literally torn to shreds from the scourging. This was the shape Jesus was in before they ever gave him his cross to head out to Calvary. Now, one of the things I take issue with from agnostics who I've heard debate this, I do not think the Lord died from shock or secondary to blood loss. There's nothing that Jesus said on the cross, nothing that the description of the crucifixion in any of the Gospels that gives us an idea that Jesus was in shock before he died. And how do I know that? When someone is shot or hit by a car, they're not sitting up and talking to you. Their eyes are glassy, their color is pale. Their blood pressure is about 60 over nothing, and they are barely conscious, if conscious at all. See, Jesus never lost consciousness. There's nothing in the description of his trials, his scourging, or his time on the cross that tells us he was incoherent mentally or lost consciousness. And something else, a physical stress. everything in the Bible tells us about the life of Jesus is that he was a healthy, early 30s male who lived through a rough life. He didn't have a home. He probably slept outside and he walked everywhere he went. He was probably, as we would say, as tough as a pine nut. I think Jesus was a hearty young man, very strong and stout physically, and that there was nothing weak or puny about him from a medical standpoint prior to the crucifixion. As far as emotional stress, I don't think Jesus had any kind of nervous breakdown. He was certainly under stress in the Garden of Gethsemane, but nothing that he said on the cross gave any indication whatsoever that he was decompensating mentally, even during his gravest hours on the cross. I've also heard cardiac arrhythmia debated at the cause of Jesus' death. And when people go into cardiac arrhythmia, if it's ventricular tachycardia or some other type of cardiac arrhythmias, one of the first things that happens is that the heart, even though it beats fast or funny, doesn't function very well as a pump. When it doesn't function well as a pump, your blood pressure drops and you lose consciousness. Again, nowhere in the Gospels do we have an account where Jesus ever lost consciousness until he died. Let's talk about the cross for just a minute. We know from Corinthian and Roman history that the crosses were usually in two parts. First, the crossbar, from very good historical accounts, can be estimated to have weighed 125 to 150 pounds and had to be about the size of a cross tie. Now, many of us have stacked or used cross ties at one time or another, or have certainly seen what they look like on the railroad tracks. I want to remind you that this was a rough, unplanned, unfinished piece of wood with splinters and spikes and rough places in it, just like you would expect to see in a railroad cross tie. When the victim's final trial and condemnation had taken place, to maximize the shame and suffering, the custom was to tie the crossbar to the victim and have him carry it through the city from his point of condemnation to his point of execution. Part of the custom was that many times these people would be forced to stagger through the streets after being scourged and beaten, with the crossbar tied to their arms. And to add to the ultimate humiliation, the victim had to bear the cross naked. Imagine how humiliating that would be in this day and time, much less how humiliating and agonizing it must have been for Jesus. The other part of the cross was an upright part, which is just like a post in the ground. Every major city at the time had an area outside the gates where they performed crucifixions. It was really not only a form of execution, but of entertainment as well. As someone condemned to crucifixion would bear the crossbar through the streets to the point of crucifixion, and once there, would be thrown onto the ground. Nails would then be driven through their hands into the crossbar. Then two forks, something similar to pitchforks, would be placed around each end of the crossbar, and they would be boosted up, and the crossbar hung on top of the upright post. Once they were braced on the upright post, both feet would then be nailed to the foot of the piece. The nail wounds. The Romans practiced crucifixion for hundreds of years, and they perfected the art of pain and suffering. And how could a man have spikes driven through his hands and feet and not bleed to death? The Romans figured out if they drove a spike through a man's wrist right at the middle, they could avoid hitting any arteries or veins. And if you go back and look at the Hebrew word for hand, it's inclusive from the fingertips to about where your wristwatch crosses your wrist. So the hand didn't necessarily mean the palm. You cannot drive a spike through a man's palm and hang him by it without pulling right out between his fingers. It's an acceptable medical fact that the muscle in your palm is not strong enough to support your body weight. In order to be able to drive spikes through the Lord's hands, they had to drive them through at the wrist. There's a strong ligament called the transverse carpal ligament that is strong enough to support the body weight. The Romans figured out that if they came about where the crease in the wrist is and drove the spike through this area, they would miss the radial artery. It's the artery people cut when they try to kill themselves by cutting their wrist, right where the doctor would take your pulse. And they would also miss what is called the ulnar artery over the little finger side. What they would do, though, is drive the nail right through the biggest nerve in the hand, called the median nerve. If any of you ever had carpal tunnel syndrome, I have, you know how uncomfortable any inflammation and irritation to that median nerve can be. When the median nerve is transected, it gives about the sensation of having an electrical cattle prod stuck to your wrist and a constant electrical shock going through your hand, and it causes the fingers to claw. In essence, the Romans devised a way they could drive a spike through a man's hand and not lose one drop of blood, while maximizing the amount of pain and suffering that a man could endure. The Romans did the same thing with the feet. They calculated where they could drive a spike through both a man's feet and not cause blood loss that would cause a victim to bleed to death. The spike would have been placed between the first and second metatarsal bones and missing the dorsal artery. There again, they drove the spike through the feet with no blood loss. The spike misses the artery but does hit the plantar nerves, thereby causing the same horrible shock sensation. Let's talk now about Jesus hanging on the cross. When hanging by their arms as a crucifixion, victim's body weight sags down. Their diaphragm functions like bellows. As the diaphragm drops into the abdomen, it pulls in air, so someone hanging on the cross had no difficulty whatsoever pulling air into their lungs. See, the tough part for people hanging on the cross was breathing out. In order for a crucifixion victim to exhale, they would have to pull up against the spikes with their hands and push up against the spikes with their feet. And I want to remind you, here's Jesus hanging on the cross, probably naked, in front of the whole city of Jerusalem. And I've already described his back to you. See, every time he took a breath, that tattered, lacerated, and riddled back was drugged and scraped across the splinters and the rough knobs and spikes protruding from the cross. Each time he breathed out, each time he uttered a word, he would have to pull up with his arms and push up with his legs. And that's why I want to remind you just how precious Jesus' words from the cross were. That's why he couldn't say more than 3 or 4 words at a time. Because when you talk, you only talk as you breathe out, not as you breathe in. See, every word Jesus spoke on the cross was spoken as he was pulling up against the nails and dragging his back against the cross. That's why what the Lord tells us, what he spoke from the cross, is very precious to me, because I know what it cost him and how badly it hurt him. Every time I think about this, it reminds me how he died for us and just how every word hurt and how he suffered just to give us every word. What did he say? He said, "Behold your son." And then he said, "Behold your mother." See, Jesus knew he had just about finished his job and done everything that he had come to do in this world. Finally, when he had done all of that, he said, "It is finished." And when he said, "It is finished," that's the last time he pulled up with his hands and pushed up with his feet, dragging his back across the cross as he hung there naked before the city of Jerusalem in total shame and humiliation, convicted and tortured and condemned for something of which he was not guilty. If you go back and look at historical accounts, you find that people actually lived on the cross, crucified for up to 6 days. And if you can, imagine a man hanging on a cross outside the gates of a city with the birds pecking at his eyes and roosting on his head. As he hangs there naked is the spectacle for the whole city. That was the point of this. It was part of the shame and humiliation that a man hang there so people could come by for a day or two and stand and mock and jeer and shout accusations and railings and blasphemy at him. The idea was to make him suffer as much as possible. Crucifixion was never intended to kill anybody. It was only intended to make a human being suffer as much as he can be afflicted upon before killing him by breaking his legs. But I don't believe Jesus died from crucifracture or from exhaustion asphyxia either. Crucifracture is what they would do when they simply grew tired of watching this agony and suffering, or when they had something better to do and wanted to end the crucifixion. They would take a spear and swing it like a ball and bat and hit the victim in the shins to break his shin bones. They'd break the tibia and then the fibula bone. And many times they would have to beat the legs for 5 or 10 minutes until they finally could break the shin bones. It takes a lot of force to break your shin bones. With the shin bone broken, the victim could no longer push up to breathe. Why didn't they break Jesus' legs? If you go back to Psalms, I believe 34th chapter, it says, "Not a bone of his body was broken." This is why Jesus' nose and jaws and cheekbones should have been broken, but couldn't have been. The 34th chapter of Psalms wouldn't let that take place. And that's why the Roman centurion didn't break his legs, because the Bible says, "Not a bone of his body was broken." And that was totally uncharacteristic of the crucifixion, because that's how crucifixion victims died. When they grew tired of you and got bored with the situation, they'd break your legs in about 4 to 6 minutes and you'd smother to death because you could no longer push up with your legs. You laid there sagging, unable to breathe out, and you were asphyxiated in about 4 to 6 minutes. And that's how the two thieves died, but Jesus was dead already. let's go back to the 19th chapter of John and what happened. What did they do when they went to the first thief? The Roman centurion broke his legs. What did he do when he went to the second thief? He broke his legs. But when the centurion went to Jesus, the Bible says he was dead already. Now, why would a young, strapping, healthy man be dead after being on the cross for 6 hours? There's absolutely no medical explanation for it at all. And excuse my interpretation here, but the Lord had no business being dead. He should have been alive just like the other two. He wasn't beaten to the point of death. His blood loss was minimal, and we know he wasn't in shock, because everything he told us from the cross made sense. He identified his mother, standing at some distance from the foot of the cross. He was able to see enough to identify her, and to identify one of the disciples. And everything he said was coherent. He was not out of his mind, and he was not having a nervous breakdown. And he wasn't even in shock from blood loss. The Lord was perfectly coherent and sane up until the moment he died. The spear wound to the Lord's side was not the cause of death either. When the centurion saw that Jesus was dead already, he thrust the spear into Jesus' side. The Bible says in Zechariah that they may look upon him who they pierced. The spear thrust was biblical prophecy fulfilled. That was one of the reasons why Jesus was already dead. See, God had a plan. We were to look upon the one they had pierced. Zechariah had to be fulfilled. Roman centurions were trained killers. They were taught how to deliver death blows that would take a man's life in a matter of seconds. A person could take a .22 through the left side of the heart and likely walk in the hospital sitting up and talking. However, if you're stabbed or shot on the right side of the heart, where the inferior and superior vena cava are emptied into the right side of the heart, you're unconscious and pretty close to dead in about 20 or 30 seconds. This blow to Jesus was no doubt delivered from the right side, through the right lung, into the heart, and into the spine. It would have penetrated somewhere between the 7th and 8th intercostal space, probably on the right. But the Bible says that blood and water came out of Jesus' side after the spear was thrust in. Now, if you take a unit of blood, drain it out of a human being's body, put it in a quart jar, and set it on top of a desk, in about 30 minutes, the red blood cells begin to settle out, and the plasma rises to the top. The plasma separates from the red blood cells. So when the soldier thrust the spear into the Lord's side, Jesus had already been dead for 30 or 45 minutes. Maybe you've never thought about that. The spear wound did not take the life of the Lord Jesus. He was dead already when they thrust the spear into his side. So let me conjecture a little bit about what I think. I think there's a very good description of the crucifixion in the Bible. And there's very good medical evidence that can be pulled out of that description that tells us that the Lord did not die in the manner that most crucifixion victims die. When the Roman centurion went to him to break his legs, he was dead already. They couldn't break his legs because the Bible said in Psalms, "Not a bone of his body shall be broken." Why then would the soldier thrust a spear into his side? Because Zechariah told us hundreds of years before that we'd look upon the one we'd pierced. And what came out? Blood and water. And I think there's enough medical evidence there that the Lord was dead at least a half an hour or an hour before. So what took the Lord's life? No man did. No man, no Roman centurion, no cross took Jesus' life. He was able to do something we've never seen another human being do. He laid down his life. When it was finished and with a loud voice, he gave up the ghost. Jesus gave his life. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, only to take it up again. See, no one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father, John 10:17-18. I'm deeply blessed. Our Lord conquers death and gives life. Amen. My friends, through this video, I hope to reveal some things that will make us meditate on the actual suffering Jesus experienced in the last hours of his life. I tried to present my conclusions about the death of Jesus based on medical research from experienced trauma physicians and my understanding of scripture. You may or may not have thought of some of the things I have pointed out to you, but I hope I shared some things with you that will make the life and death of your Savior a little bit more precious. And thank you for listening and watching. I hope you enjoyed this message. If you did, please remember to like, share, and again, please subscribe. If you are encouraged to give a donation, there will be a PayPal link in the description below. And until next time, God bless you and your families. Please be safe. Thank you.